This podcast is brought to you by the School of Advanced Study, University of London. All of our podcasts are available from our website, www.sas.ac.uk.
We have a very distinguished guest as our keynote speaker today, Miss Yasmin Sooka. And I'm very grateful for Yasmin, who has come back to London after only being here a few weeks ago and also managed to wriggle out of a board meeting to be here today. All of you will know Yasmin, but for those, in case there's one or two people who don't, Yasmin is the Executive Director of the Foundation for Human Rights in South Africa. She practices as a human rights lawyer during the apartheid era. In 1995, she was appointed as a commissioner on the Truth and Reconciliation Commission and was responsible for the final report. From 1998 to 2001, she was also an acting judge at the High Court. Ms. Sooka is widely regarded as an expert on transitional justice and has been a consultant to a number of governments, commissions and civil society organisations. She had also been appointed to the UN, by the United Nations to the Sierra Leone Truth and Reconciliation Commission. Yasmin was also a member of the UN Secretary-General's panel of experts on accountability in Sri Lanka, and that is why she is here today. So Yasmin, thank you very much for being here today, and it's that I have much pleasure inviting you to speak for our keynote speaker today. Thank you. Thank you.
I'd like to thank the organisers of this meeting for inviting me to speak. I've titled my paper, Building Sustainable Peace in Sri Lanka, with a focus on truth, justice and accountability. As a former member of two truth commissions and having worked in many post-conflict countries over the last 20 years, it has been my experience that sustainable peace cannot be achieved without addressing the past, the violations that have been committed, and of course the root causes of the conflict. In 1993, former President Mandela, when he accepted the Nobel Peace Prize, and I quote, "A new society cannot be created by reproducing the repugnant past, however refined or enticingly repackaged." In 1995, he went on to say that as all countries recover from the trauma and wounds of the past, they have to devise mechanisms not only for handling past human rights violations, but also to ensure that the dignity of victims, survivors, and relatives is restored. In Sri Lanka, of course, the conflict ended in May 2009 with the declaration of victory by the government of Sri Lanka. But it's important to note that while the battle may have been won militarily, in reality, the conflict itself is not over. Since 2009, the government of Sri Lanka has been the subject of increasing international scrutiny because of the allegations regarding war crimes and crimes against humanity, and because of the failure of government to deal conclusively with the issue of accountability for these alleged crimes. In the last few weeks, we've also seen the impeachment, the attempt to impeach the Chief Justice of Sri Lanka, and I think all of these should be raising alarm bells for anybody who's concerned. The conflict, of course, in Sri Lanka has raged for a period of more than 30 years and has been characterized by ethnic violence, political and social exclusion for minorities, disappearances, extrajudicial killings, and the intimidation and violence against those considered to be opponents of the state. The final stages of the conflict began in September 2008 with the removal of the international community and the UN from the war zone in the valley, and ended officially in May 2009. In May of that year, the Secretary General of the UN, Ban Ki-moon, visited Sri Lanka and released a joint statement agreed to by the President of Sri Lanka on post-conflict priorities, including the need to address accountability. At the same time, May 2009, the Human Rights Council held a special session which resulted in member states congratulating Sri Lanka for having defeated terrorism. I would like to believe that at the time this resolution took place, this was done with many states not understanding the full import of what had happened in Sri Lanka. Despite the resolution, though, the Secretary General continued to raise the issue of accountability with the government of Sri Lanka. And finally, in September 2009, he advised the government that he was considering appointing a commission of experts to advise him on this question of accountability. This communication undoubtedly is why the government then established its own lessons learned commission. But despite this step, the SG established his own panel of experts in June 2010 to advise him on accountability. And I, of course, was a member of the three-person panel. We concluded our work and handed over our report to the Secretary General in April 2011. And of course, the report was made public shortly thereafter. In terms of our findings, we concluded that between August 2008 and May 2009, the war between the government of Sri Lanka and the Liberation Tigers of Tamil Eelai entered its final stages, and estimated 360,000 or more civilians were crowded into an ever smaller part of the Vani area of northern Sri Lanka, where many died as a result of sustained shelling, illness and starvation. And in the aftermath of the conflict, almost 280,000 survivors were forcibly interned in military-run camps outside the area of conflict. The panel was shocked in its work to find out that the government of Sri Lanka asserted that the war had been fought with zero civilian casualties and that it had mounted a rescue mission given the extraordinary loss of life that we encountered that had happened in such a short period of time. In stark contrast, the evidence obtained by the panel revealed a very different version of the final stages of the war that has been maintained to this day by the government. The panel found credible allegations which, if proven, indicate that a wide range of serious violations of international humanitarian law and international human rights law were committed by both sides. The panel also concluded that the conduct of the war represented a grave assault on the entire regime of international law designed to protect individual dignity during war and peace. We found credible allegations that the Sri Lankan military had killed civilians through widespread shelling, had shelled hospitals and humanitarian objects, had denied humanitarian assistance, had violated the human rights of civilians and, of course, combatants, and it had violated the human rights of those outside the conflict zone, such as the media. The panel found credible allegations that the Tamil Tigers had used civilians as a human buffer, had killed civilians attempting to escape tiger control, had used military equipment in the proximity of civilians, had forcibly recruited children, had used forced labor, and had killed civilians using suicide attacks. The government had also systematically deprived civilians in the conflict zone of humanitarian aid in the form of food and medical supplies, adding to their suffering. The government deliberately underestimated the number of civilians in order to deprive them of humanitarian aid. And we said that tens of thousands of civilians had been killed between January and May 2009. Many of those died anonymously in the final stages of the war. But it did not stop there. In the aftermath of the conflict, the government subjected the civilians who managed to escape the conflict zone to further deprivation and suffering. Screening for Tamil Tigers took place without any transparency or external scrutiny. Some of those separated by the screening were summarily executed, while many women were raped. Others simply disappeared. The IDPs were detained in close overcrowded camps where they were deprived of their basic rights. And the conditions in the camps resulted in many unnecessary deaths. Interrogations and torture in the camps were routine. Suspected Tamil Tigers were taken to other facilities where they faced further abuse. What makes this conflict different in this decade is the sheer magnitude of civilian skill in such a short space of time. The panel of the experts suggested that tens of thousands were killed, and we estimate this figure to be around 40,000. However, records that have been published in the leaked Petri report suggest that this number may be higher. The Bishop of Manor has said that around 150,000 people still remain unaccounted for. Establishing the figures and the names of the dead should be a priority for the government of Sri Lanka. They were able to do this during the tsunami, and given the excellent records of the village dromedaries, should be able to do this again. In our report, we stated that the credible allegations demand a serious investigation and the prosecution of those responsible. If the allegations are proved, senior commanders and members of politicians on both sides are liable for prosecution under international criminal law. The panel noted that the Sri Lankan government's attempted accountability consisted solely of investigating the actions of the previous government in terms of whether it should have acceded to the peace agreement and, of course, the conduct of the Tamil Tigers. And it is not really their mandate to consider the present government's actions during the final stages of the war. The panel also considered whether the government's own lessons learned and reconciliation commission could satisfy the commitment to accountability, and we concluded that it could not. We also found that the Sri Lankan justice system was incapable of providing accountability, given that the independence of the Attorney General had been eroded, and the continuation of emergency regulations and the Prevention of Terrorism Act precluded the judiciary at the time from holding the government accountable on human rights issues. We also said that the military courts and other domestic institutions were incapable of dealing with this issue as well. Since 2009, we have seen no initiative to deal with accountability, and we then recommended the establishment of an independent international inquiry into the alleged violations of international law. We also said that the government should demonstrate that it will carry out genuine investigations of the alleged violations committed by both sides. In March 2012, after intense lobbying and amidst great resistance from the government of Sri Lanka, the Human Rights Council passed a resolution on promoting reconciliation and accountability in Sri Lanka and requested that the government address these alleged violations of international law. It also called on the country to prepare a comprehensive action plan detailing the steps that the government has taken and will take to implement the recommendations of its own structure, the Lessons Learned Commission. The Sri Lankan government recently announced national action plans purports to implement the LRC's recommendations, but in fact, it rejects the Commission's central finding, the need to initiate independent investigations and to restore the independence of the judiciary, the police, and other public bodies. The action plan proposes only flawed inquiries into alleged war crimes and other serious human rights violations, but it does so relying on the very institutions that are tainted, the police and the military. It does nothing to establish independent institutions which are able to hold to account state agencies. The action plan, of course, also rejects the LRRC's call for an independent analysis of the Channel 4 video to establish the truth or otherwise of the executions of naked and bound prisoners it appears to detect. In this regard, the rapporteur on extrajudicial killings has found that the video is a genuine one and has in fact requested the government of Sri Lanka to invite him to visit. Needless to say, he has not heard anything. In terms of the military, the action plan promises only that the military will complete ongoing disciplinary processes being conducted in terms of armed force statutes and upon conclusion take action to prosecute where relevant. But no information has been released about which incidents or which military personnel may be under investigation. But it's important to note that Sri Lanka's human rights problems did not end with war. There have been scores of disappearances and political killings even since the LLRC report in December 2011, and the prospects for reconciliation are further away than ever. Despite government claims to have reduced the role of the military in the Tamil majority north and east, a key demand of the Human Rights Council's resolution, reports from the ground confirm continued military control over virtually all aspects of life. By refusing to restart negotiations with the main Tamil party, the Tamil National Alliance, or to allow elections to be held in the northern provincial capital, the government is fueling anger amongst Tamils and weakening support for the moderate TNA approach. At the recent session in November of the Human Rights Council, Sri Lanka was subject to the UPR process, in which many states made extremely important points related to accountability. In Sri Lanka, the rule of law and democracy are at risk. The current Chief Justice is facing impeachment simply for doing her job. The impeachment proceedings come amid rising tensions between the Supreme Court and President Rajapaksa's administration. The Supreme Court blocked efforts by the President to centralize certain powers at the expense of elected provincial councils through the Divanagumma Bill. The government's proposed change would have meant that one of the president's brothers, the current cabinet minister, would control more than $600 million in development money. The Chief Justice, of course, is simply doing her job in suggesting that the process that was being used was in line with the laws on Sri Lanka, and for that she is facing impeachment. The triumphalism of the government in winning the war has translated into victor's justice, with no accountability for those responsible for war crimes and crimes against humanity. The government continues to demonstrate its contempt for the international community by designating many of the generals allegedly responsible for these crimes as diplomats to different countries around the world. General Shivendra Silva, who commanded the 58th Battalion, when he's alleged to be responsible for the killing of many civilians, and of course the LTT leadership, was posted to New York as the deputy head of mission. Asian countries demanded that he be removed from the SG's advisory group on peacekeeping, and in fact, he did not attend any of the meetings and conveniently found himself not in New York when those meetings took place. The government, embarrassed by the situation, have announced that he's to be posted in South Africa, where activists are already gearing up to prevent his arrival in the country. The government of Sri Lanka has today failed to implement any political solution and to deal with many of the recommendations related to ongoing human rights abuses in the country. The militarization of the north continues unabated, and I'm sure many of the people here present will speak more of this. In addition, and more dangerously, the history of Sri Lanka is being revised. Revisionism, with the aim of writing out the Tamil history and replacing it with the Buddhist narrative. Archaeologists and anthropologists are being brought on board to do this. In the north, more stupas are being constructed, and the cultural history of the Tamils is being destroyed. More profoundly, families are not allowed to mourn their dead, and this, of course, is inherent to their religious beliefs. In its report to the Secretary General, of course, the panel of experts also recommended a review of the UN's own actions in dealing with Sri Lanka, with a view to learning lessons for the future. In a confidential letter to the Secretary General, the panel of experts described UN action as a low point for the organization as a whole, and said that some UN agencies and individuals had failed in their mandates and did not uphold the UN's founding principles. In response to this call, the Secretary General established an internal review panel on UN action in Sri Lanka. This was led by Charles Petrie, who was tasked with providing an assessment of UN action during the final stages of the conflict and its aftermath, with a view to identifying institutional and structural strengths and weaknesses, and making recommendations to ensure a more effective UN response in similar situations. In fact, this has probably become the Secretary General's own Rwanda moment. This week, the panel headed by Charles Petrie handed over its report to the Secretary General. A redacted version of the report has been made public, and the report vindicates the panel and is deeply critical of the UN and its agencies on the ground and the government of Sri Lanka. The report makes the point that many have argued that many deaths could have been averted had the Security Council and the Secretary, backed by the UN country team, spoken out loudly early on, notably by publicising the casualty numbers. Others argue that the question is less whether the UN should assume responsibility, but more whether it did everything it could to assist the victims. The panel's conclusion is that events in Sri Lanka mark a grave failure of the UN to adequately respond to early warning and the evolving events during the final stage of the conflict and its aftermath, to the detriment of hundreds of thousands of civilians and in contradiction with the principles and responsibilities adopted by member states, the secretariat agencies and programs. The report concludes that the UN system failed to meet its responsibilities, highlighting in particular the role played by the secretariat, the agencies, the program of the UN country team, and members of the Security Council and the Human Rights Council. The panel, led by Charles Petrie, also makes the point that the magnitude of the violence in Bani, following decades of strife and injustice, continue to be felt by Sri Lanka's communities. Sri Lanka's peaceful and stable progress will require a process of accountability and reconciliation and a political solution to the long-standing grievances of all communities, as well as a response to ongoing and new concerns and prevention and protection in the future. The Secretary General himself yesterday said that the UN intends to learn from this experience. Of course, it is the function of member states to make sure that the UN does put in place measures to ensure that those lessons are actually learned. The next Commonwealth Heads of State meeting is to be held next year in Sri Lanka, but it has been interpreted by the government as a continuation of itself and its boundaries. A number of countries, including the United Kingdom, are considering whether they should attend the meeting. Some of those who will attend have said that they intend to raise the human rights issues with the government of Sri Lanka. For those who will go, it's important to ensure that if they attend that meeting, that they need to agree, that they need to raise this question of accountability. If peace is to prevail in Sri Lanka, then accountability and a peaceful solution are necessary. As we know from experiences across the world, it cannot be achieved through impunity. Furthermore, no society can claim to be truly democratic without the restoration of the rule of law, particularly where the scale of atrocities have been so devastating that they cannot and should not be ignored. Truth recovery, reparations, and justice are important for both the victims and the society. Reconciliation efforts must be accompanied by an acknowledgement of the past, the acceptance of responsibility, and the rebuilding of trust. Tamils and other minorities in Sri Lanka, despite being Sri Lankan citizens, have not been treated as if they are full citizens, and this is something that needs to be restored. All of us here should remember the role played by Sunny Ranko, and of course the work of the Eminent Persons Group, who were involved in the struggle against the apartheid in South Africa. Without the Commonwealth and its lobbying initiatives, I'm not sure that peace in South Africa would have come so soon. So there are examples to follow, and I think it's up to the Commonwealth leadership to actually decide on whether they will be courageous in setting the tone for Sri Lanka. Sri Lanka is really, I think, a timely moment for the world. The Secretary General himself has said that hopefully these lessons will also be considered in the light of what is happening in Syria today. If we are to honor the dead, then the least we can do is make sure that they are accounted for and that they are named, so that their families can finally put to rest the living in a twilight zone, never knowing whether they are alive or dead. This is what we owe to the people of Sri Lanka. This is not just about Tamils, but it is about the fight for democracy in Sri Lanka, which affects all of its citizens. Thank you. Yasmin, thank you for not only a thought-provoking speech, but also a heart-wrenching one. We now have about half an hour for questions from the floor. So we would like to be told. Could anybody who speaks please say your name and affiliation?
Madam High Lord, I'm British Council Forum. Thank you very much for this wonderful report that you bring to your colleagues. Actually, two questions. The first part is that the report is still hasn't got the UN official number, and then I know that the report has been transmitted to the British Council. Should I explain how we can make it an official document? And the UN has failed before the Rwanda, for example, and the next time they said never again. In this instance, how can you share, for example, an independent international investigation into what has happened to Sri Lanka?
This is a gentleman. Yeah, this is a UK citizen born in south of Sri Lanka. I wonder whether you are correct in asserting that TNA as a moderate group, when you realize all along they were playing alongside LGT, really speaking as the spokespeople for LGT. Number two, how did you derive at these figures when the government itself, which has a far better handle on the situation, thinks that the number of people who unfortunately died in this situation has something like 7,000? And in fact, among the people who were in the refugee camps was Prabhakaran's own mother and father, because he felt more comfortable living among the in the one, because government was providing all the food than medicine to all the people, despite the war going on. So there's a lot of nonsense developed by various other organizations which are financing this war from Europe and other places.
The question is about the numbers.
Numbers. And then what are you going to do about the continuing activities of these overseas groups which are extorting money and continuing to create false propaganda, like that famous kind of film?
Okay,
how did you find that it's a true account?
Thank you very much for those two questions. And one for the last question here.
People have started to see
your name affiliation.
Moving for peace and justice in Sri Lanka. People have recently started to say that, or the UN has been doing this here, Rwanda, there, now in Sri Lanka. But along with that, people must remember that the Sri Lankan government, successive governments, have been doing this from the time of independence till today. For example, this book, after the 1958 riots, the manuscript was smuggled out of Sri Lanka and came brought into this country to produce here, and then it was banned there. Starting from there, or even before that, until today, even after the war was over, after the bloodbath, the last 3.5 years were much worse oppression than the previous 61 years.
Just a comment. No question.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much.
Can I ask those ones?
In terms of the referral of the report of the panel of experts, I think the Secretary General made a huge mistake. What he did is he passed it on to the Human Rights Council to view, he said that they should read it. But in reality, he should have, in the way in which he referred it, demanded that in fact it be tabled before the Human Rights Council. Now, there's been a huge debate, and of course this is the classic way in which the Sri Lankan government has always argued. They don't deal with the substance of the report, but what they tackle is the procedural questions. And when the panel of experts was appointed, the Secretary General actually had to obtain a legal opinion from his own Office of Legal Affairs to determine, in fact, whether he had
the legal capacity to set up this kind of panel without it coming through either the Human Rights Council or the Security Council. And so what the Sri Lankan government has done has been to assert that this is a private report of the Secretary General giving him advice and not a formal UN report. And that's sad because what they should look at is what is in the report and not the exact process. I think the Secretary General, and if you read Charles Secretary's report, you'll see that he sets out, in fact, the advice that the SG actually sought on this issue. So the problem has been that the referral of that report to the Human Rights Council has been a problem. And that really is also a question of the role of member states, because when I spoke to the president of the council, she indicated that it is simply for a member state to actually place it on the agenda and ask me for that to be discussed. So pressure should be placed on member states to make that official. In terms of the questions of the TNA being a moderate group, in terms of I think it's fair to say that they do represent the people who are there, and in terms of what has happened before, they are fairly moderate. But you may find that if no real attempt is made to deal with them, that people will get tired of a group that cannot deliver on a political space or, in fact, some deal which allows them to live with relative independence. And I think that will present more dangerous consequences for Sri Lanka.
If I may answer that question slightly.
Can you just answer the question?
I would also like to say that, one of the things that the panel is very careful about in its own work is not to rely on any of the sources of the, any of the NGOs or groups who are working on what had happened during the final stages of the war. We were very clear that we should not be manipulated by any group. And so we ourselves, the government did not allow us to enter Sri Lanka, despite us asking for that repeatedly. But what we ourselves did is we traveled to meet key people who had been on the ground in the valley at the time, who traveled out at great risk to themselves, and we obtained direct evidence about what happened in the conflict area. We also had access to all of the UN agency reports that existed, with access to all of the UN staff, in fact, who were quite angry about what was happening on the ground. We also had access to satellite footage, which we used extensively to confirm whether or not the allegations were correct. We were very clear that we could not stick the SG with the report, which would be based on what the ICG said, what Human Rights Watch said, even though their work has been fairly credible. And in terms of the Channel 4 video, I would like to say that much of that you will see confirms much of what we say in our report. There was one issue that we were not able to deal with conclusively, and that is the question of the white flag surrender. We saw video footage, but it came right at the end. And so we said to the Secretary General that this is a matter that should be separately investigated. The matter was then taken up by Christoph Haynes, the rapporteur on extrajudicial killings. He continued with the work of Philip Austin, who had been the rapporteur before him. And in fact, they found that the video is in fact authentic. So, outside of the work of the panel, there's been other work that has been taking place. I think you will find in both reports, and that's why I make the point that this is not about one ethnic group. I think the greater casualty is Sri Lanka and democracy in Sri Lanka. We know that throughout the periods, Sri Lanka holds one of the records for being the highest disappearance countries in the world. The torture of civilians is a problem. And of course, this is the largest diaspora that has been displaced in the world. There are now more Tamils living in Toronto than we have in Sri Lanka itself. And that itself should cause countries to ask questions.
Thank you. Can I have a show of hands for the next questions, please? Any more questions? One question there and one question there, please. So your name and affiliation?
Yes, my name's Mark Brown and I consist of being a freelance journalist. I wonder if Ms. Sooka would comment about the role of Vijay and Ambia and the seemingly blockage of feedback and information coming upwards from the lower limit of the UN that she's just referred to. So seemingly a blockage of information up to the Secretary General. Basically, the fact that information surely was known at the time of the Civil War conflict at the closing days and days after, and it was done. Member states weren't given a coherent strategy in response. I'm quoting the leaked report now. The UN discredited, it's discredited for its systematic failure. Sorry, they're my words. Here's a quote, which the crisis management structure failed to execute a coherent strategy in response to early warnings and subsequent international human rights and humanitarian law violations against civilians. The point about Vijay and Ambia is, most directly, you may be knowing it, Ms. Sooka, is that he communicated to two senior LTTE leaders in the closing days that if they surrendered, they would take passage out of there and they were subsequently assassinated. Would you like to comment on that?
Thank you very much.
And
the second question here, please.
Yes, I'm Leonean, the Institute for Common Studies. Thank you very much for your presentation. Clearly, at the time that the UN experts panel reported, the Sri Lanka government was saying that no civilians were killed in the last stages of the war. A totally sort of absurd position to take, which was modified and changed by their own lessons learned in reconciliation. I suppose my question, and I have come to comments, but my question first about that is, to what extent do you accept the criticism of the way in which the lessons learned in the Reconciliation Commission set about its gathering evidence that it took and evidence ignored? To what extent do you think it was a step forward in the process of reconciliation, or are you overwhelmed, as it were, by the what you've been criticised as its failures? A second question, really, getting an observation about this leak of the apparent leak of the internal UN report. One wonders why it should be leaked and whether it would be published. But it seems clear that probably one of the reasons is that in a time of international law where the responsibility to protect, international responsibility to protect, is a fairly new idea and only able to be applied in very selective circumstances, which didn't apply in Sri Lanka. I mean, the UN did not have a mandate to step in and protect. It's clear from Francis Harrison's book, the evidence that you were able to take, that many of the target strategy in the last months, apart from mingling with the civilians who were supposed to be then trying to protect, was to force a situation where the international community would have intervened and let the tigers retain some sort of political status, political credibility, which otherwise they were going to lose, and which in fact they did lose. In all the talk about war crimes, and one talks to, I've recently been in Sri Lanka, and talking to people there, who Sinhalese, who pour scorn on the idea of war crimes, and they will say, well, these things happen in war. The LTT took a gamble that they were going to go for all-out war, and they lost. and the OTT would support it to much greater extent than many of us in Britain would be happy with by the Tamil diaspora community.
You wrap this up into a final question.
Well, that is the comment. And so my question arising out of that is, so do you think the UN has a responsibility to protect?
Thank you very much. And a final comment here, follow-up question.
When you look at the last pages of the war, I can't remember, as I said, in the South Pacific, in Akura, in the month before the final victory of mosque, there was a large celebration at a mosque, and it was bombed, leading to the death of some 30 people, and hundreds injured. And they had a vast firepower all over the country, with so many cells operating, with large stocks of explosives, semtex and so on, financed from various diaspora groups. Now, I went to the university in Sri Lanka, and although the population of Tamils at that time was something like 12%, more than 50% of my batchmates were good friends and Tamils. So it was a very successful burgeoning democracy, and it remains so today. Large number of Tamils live happily in Colombo, and occupying some of the best houses in Colombo. So, and occupying the financial wealth, professional standing, in the profession. So, please do not compare it with your own home country, Africa, South Africa, in 1980s or 90s.
Thank you.
It's a successful democracy, and it remains so.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. I think in the remark, there are really two questions, and what you should remember is Charles Petrie, in his report, he actually sets out, I think, in great detail, the letter that we handed to the Secretary General. And the reason we actually said that there was a real need to look into the conduct of the UN at many different levels is because we spoke to many UN staff at lower levels, some who were in the Bali, some who were the Sri Lankan national staff of the UN. And I think we encountered probably trauma on the part of many of them who found that the UN did not serve the people it was supposed to protect very well. Many of them spoke about whether the UN should have been in September 2008, and many argued that some of them, out of their own initiative, started to look at the counting of the figures. And of course, there's one of the big issues that Charles deals with in his report is the divisions within the UN itself. When the High Commissioner for Human Rights decided to break ranks and in fact to issue out the casualty figures. And even those, were fairly low. And if there's an annex in Charles's documents, the lectical, which really sets out different sets of figures. So this is, Sri Lanka has a very good system at a local village level. And, much of the information that we gathered from many of the headmen who are on the ground was how they themselves were counting on a daily basis. So I think the UN at a whole host of levels has to answer questions, and of course accountability should start at home. Now, I think the second question that you raised is about Vijay Nambiar and his own role in the white flag surrender issue. If you read our report, we received a range of different accounts from many different people, and because we were not able to verify it at the end, we actually recommended that this was certainly a matter that needed an investigation. And I would argue that position remains. But I do think member states need to ask the question of it is about the special role that the UN often provides. They should be providing the numbers, the figures, an update on what is actually happening. And then, of course, it's up to member states to decide how they're going to deal with this information. If they don't do that, then I think there is a big question mark, and that's something that has to be dealt with.
I do think that even though we were very critical of the Lessons Learned Commission, and that was based, of course, on our own interaction with the Sri Lankan government. You know, they met us in New York in the sort of final weeks of December, where we had sent a range of questions to them. And very clearly in our analysis of their responses, the Lessons Learned Commission had been modeled really on the commission here. And its one mandate was to look into whether or not previous governments should, you know, actually erred in entering into the peace negotiations. And of course, the second role was to look into the conduct of the LTTE. But nevertheless, and I think what is important for us, because we monitored what was coming through on a daily basis, in the north, for instance, you will find that many women took the opportunity to go to the Lessons Learned Commission's hearings to actually place on record the fact that they had relatives and family members for whom they could not account. We also read and we interviewed some of them. Many of them were not allowed to speak. And of course, I think on the key question in terms of the role of the military, the commission exonerated them. But nevertheless, despite that, many of its recommendations, beginning number one, a proper investigation, the fact that it talked about the militarization, and a range of questions relating to ordinary human rights conditions, the need for livelihoods, the need for people to get on with their lives, all of these things were raised by the Lessons Learned Commission. And so we argued in the March Council meeting, why are they not implementing what their own structure has recommended that they do? So, surprisingly, I think the Lessons Learned Commission said some very good things, but we don't find in the National Action Plan much of that has entered the action plan. And so if one just goes on what their own body has suggested, they have fallen far short. So when we come to the next March resolution, I think they will have to be asked those questions. In terms of the UN's role, I mean, most UN agencies spend their whole lives preparing for this moment of conflict. But if you find, as he set out in Charles's report, that when the moments arrive, they found themselves wanting to be there so much, putting to them to deal with development, that what they put at risk was their other goal. And I think that's a dilemma and something that should be looked at in the future. And the dilemma, as Charles just expressively, is something that I think many member states should ask for the debate on. Because I think with development, you know, and of course Colombo is a very comfortable place to be. So people like being there. And of course if you want to stay there, then you've toed the line. But then what does that mean for you, for your other mandate? And I think the report eloquently addresses that question. In terms of the LTT, and I agree with you, and of course if you read our report, we have pretty hard line on the fact that the LTT took a gamble. They gambled with people's lives. But having said that, you know, what we explored were also the current jurisprudence on this issue. And even though the LTT also were amongst the civilian population, if you look at the readings in law, that doesn't change the composition and the character of the civilian population. And that did not excuse what in fact the military and the LTT did. And so we're very careful in our report to make those findings as well. In terms of the bombings of the mosque, and I think we're very careful. We go into what the LTT did, and I would suggest that you read our report and you will see that we examine in great detail what the LTT did in those final stages, including many of the suicide bombings. And we make findings that they too were responsible for war crimes and crimes against humanity.
Thank you very much, Yasmin. Any other questions? Okay, Yasmin, Fred, and then to Leonean.
Pass me. Ramford Institute. I'm interested in process. What has happened to your report? Has it been distributed to all member states of the UN? How can we get a copy here? I presume we can download it, but it sounds rather wrong. I mean, are you the person who is trying to publicize it worldwide? Could you just answer that?
Thank you.
Just a quick point of information.
You said your name and affiliation.
Sorry, Fred Carter from Sri Lanka Campaign for Peace and Justice. Just a quick point of information because I think it's important for my friends to be for the benefit of the broadcast. The Petra report was made public. What happened is on Tuesday, the BBC ran a story saying they had sight of it. On Wednesday, the UN then published it in full. And they said they didn't plan to do that all along. Whether that's an argument they made with the benefit of hindsight is debatable. But they adapted certain sections. Now what then happened is they realised there was a technical glitch which allowed those attractions to be read, and various newspapers published those adaptations. And then the final stage was yesterday, a blog called Inner City Press published what they claim was the deleted executive summary which did begin the document. So the UN did make a reasonable effort of transparency, but only about 90%, but then the BBC and others filled in the 10%. And maybe they would have published it in full straight away if it hadn't been previously.
Thank you, Fred. If anybody wants to have blow-by-blow accounts of this coming out from the UN, I recommend you join Fred's email. Quite impossible every single day. The gentleman at the back here, please, from Payment.
My name's Chris Landon from LYG. Just a simple question. We referred to how there are good local British level records. I think anyone getting vague information. Has that sort of information been collated? My second question, what is your assessment of attempts like the extraordinary events census evaluation, which are giving the EVE process, the extraordinary events census by the Department of Census, those sort of data collection exercises?
In terms of the proceeds, I think it's up to, it certainly is available on the website. I think it was dispatched by the President to member states, but I think the big question is, can a member state put a resolution forward saying they want it to be discussed? There's no doubt what it did do based on member states, and so they pushed for the March resolution, but they also agreed that Sri Lanka should be given some time, and so they've been given a year, and they will come back to the Council next year. And I think the important thing is to look at this question of the casualty figures, to look at the question of accountability, and to look at what can be done there. And I think Fred could probably send it to you quite easily. I do think that, you know, in my discussions with Charles and certainly with the there always was an intention that the report should be made public. Of course, once you leak it, then it does create extra pressure for the report then to be published. But I think it was always an intention, because there's a sense in the UN that these things were leaked, and so if you try to suppress it, it's just not helpful. But I think the problem has been with the bad redactions, and of course now people are piecing that together and then trying to draw conclusions. In terms of the local village reports, I think that if you speak to the dromedaries, they do have records. I think within the UN system at the time, there were a number of UN officials who were trying to do a daily count of people who died and people who were missing. And based on their records, those were the first figures that in fact were in. And if you look at the back of the each report, there are a set of tables which set out various figures. And I'm not sure of the census.
I'm going to brief my position as chair to answer the question. We had a conference yesterday on Commonwealth reform, and in a whole host of areas, there was a general sense that the Commonwealth shouldn't be doing its own thing, it should always be trying to help existing international processes. Now, within the Commonwealth, the Secretary General has the authority to make pronouncements, to appoint special envoys, and to refer countries to CMAC. CMAC, which is the Commonwealth Ministerial Action Group established to protect Commonwealth values, has the authority to put countries on its agenda, to send ministerial groups to a country, and worst case scenarios, to suspend countries. And of course, member governments have a role as well. And in the Commonwealth, we have a number of different governments, many from South Africa, many from Africa, sort of Sierra Leone, Mozambique, civil war, but South Africa, Rwanda, and Solomon Islands in the Pacific, many countries that have been through some kind of civil war or experienced atrocities and have embraced some kind of transitional justice. What can these different Commonwealth agencies and groups actually do to help the existing processes in the UN and elsewhere to try and move things forward in Sri Lanka? And whilst we're thinking, I'll just check to see if there are any other final questions for this session. One from Stuart, and one from here at the front.
Stuart Mill, round table. At the time of the ending of the war, when many of us sort of viewed with horror what was happening, I think we found the statements of the UN senior officials on the ground, the senior most of it, was it John Hunt? I can't remember whether it was. We certainly looked to them, as I did anyway, for some degree of reassurance that although this was a terrible, bloody end to a conflict, it was essentially a military conflict, and there was no, there was, I wouldn't say there was no, but there was not a sense of the scale of humanitarian disaster that was unfolding. I haven't read the Peter report, so I don't know whether this is covered in there, but would we expect to see that question of how the UN behaved in terms of its public role in relation to the world as a force of reassurance and truth, if you like.
Thank you, Sue. And final question.
Sorry, question. Comment to make about the number when I came. The figures were taken from government figures in October 2008, 420,000 people in Burnley. And it was surrounded by bombs. They couldn't leave without going into the camp. But 280,000 went into camp at the end of the war. So that's why you got the exact figure of 146,639. That's one thing. The second thing is that the government always underplayed how many people actually lived in Burnley. And they said there were 70,000 people and there were 420,000 there. And it was like the leaked satellite service that actually exposed to the world that there were 250,000 people on a strip in Mullivaka.
Thank you for that clarification.
Now,
for this, to you, sir, any final critical remarks?
But I think many of the Commonwealth countries are also members of the UN. Some of them are members of the Human Rights Council. So I think there's a need to make sure that the panel of experts report, the Charles Spedding's report, are all actually read and read carefully. Because I think in the end, this is what you do learn about both the Human Rights Council and the Security Council. It is about member states who form blocks on particular issues, and it's, you know, that kind of lobby that is going to make sure whether something happens. And so there's a real need for Commonwealth countries perhaps to get together, because at the end of the day, and I think this is important to say, in Sri Lanka we probably have the most popular president to date. We should not underestimate that. And of course, when you are so popular, what does lie within your hands is the potential to create opportunities for sustainable peace. And so this is not about making Sri Lanka a pariah state, but it's about trying to find the gaps and the loopholes to ensure that they do the right thing. And that's really what we need to look at. Many people have suggested that, like Court of Law, we have a special envoy. You know, that may be something people look at. But I think the important thing to ask is, how do you use Chago? Because quite clearly, there will be many member states to go. There will be others who say the best way is to engage, some will boycott. But I think the most of them will go. And so the question is, how do you use that as an opportunity for real lobbying and for real political engagement? And so the question also of a political solution that is meaningful for people who live on the ground, the demilitarization of the north, I think is a really big issue. And you know, no one today has seen the people who in fact were segregated. If you also look at the question of the rehabilitation process, there are real questions around that. And so all of these are issues that should in fact be raised. In terms of the UN's role, I would, you know, suggest you read Charles's report.
report, because it actually does give you a fairly accurate account, and there were a number of annexures there which actually in fact encapsulate the debates which were taking place. But there is no doubt that you know, the information got stuck somewhere, and there's a big question about whether or not that had been made available. And I certainly think that if the figures on the casualties had really been made public and had been really accurate, people would have really got worried. I mean, nowhere in the world in the last 10 years have you seen such a high number of people who have died in such a short space of time. And these are not combatants. These are civilians. That's what we need to remember. And then, of course, you know, the doctors who were there, they were, in fact, sending out frantic messages about what they needed in terms of supplies. The food that was being sent into the valley was limited to 70,000 people when 280,000 people were stuck there. Now, you can imagine, I mean, you read our report to really get a sense of what it meant for these human beings. I mean, Francis's book describes, I think, quite eloquently the human suffering of people. But imagine, you know, this large group of people stuck between two armies, one that's trying to advance and bombard, and the other that is trying to use them as a buffer. And they are trapped in between. If you see the footage of the kind of operations that the doctors were performing, the kind of circumstances they were working under, it is absolutely horrifying. And I think there's a real question that the world has to answer about why this was allowed to go on. We have access to satellite footage, and if you look at the footage and you look at people trapped in the small piece of land, do you know what it does to you psychologically? When you leave the old and the dying behind, because you are also running to leave the bombardment. I mean, one of the terrible things about this, the pernicious thing, is the creation of these three, you know, no fire zones. And then the people concentrate in that zone and they are bombed. That is perverse. And nobody can, there's no human explanation for this. And even, I mean, one of the arguments the government of Sri Lanka uses is that because they were fighting an asymmetrical conflict, the laws of war don't apply to them. And I think a message that has to be sent back, this is a moment to take a stand, is that the war on terrorism has had many casualties, but we should not allow it to erode a human rights system that has been built up over decades. The responsibility is all ours, and I think it's the time people take a stand on this.
Thank you, Yasmin.